Once again, we want to wish all the mothers a happy Mother's Day to you. Thank you for being a mother, loving your kids. If you didn't get a chance to, there is a present for all moms outside the chapel. If you didn't get one on your way in, make sure you pick one up off the table on your way out. Just a little token just to say thank you. And also, we have a couple of gifts that we'd like to give away during the service. And the first one goes to the newest mother. This is the person who has the youngest baby here. So, let's start off with 6 months. Does anybody have a baby under 6 months old? All right, Jennifer and DJ. All right, you guys are the winners. So, brother, we'll get back to it. All right, now we have the grand prize. It's a little suitcase set. It has a lunch pail in there and an umbrella, and also a card with a gift card in it. And this one goes to the mother with the most offspring present. So children, grandchildren, son-in-law, daughter-in-law, so on and so forth. So let's start out with five. If you have five offspring present with you and your mother, raise your hand up for me so we can see it. Raise it nice and high. We've got a couple here, a few here. All right, how about six? Do we have anybody with six present?
We've got one here and one there.
Seven present? Eight present? All right, we have a winner.
All right, well, we're going to continue worshiping together. Thank you.
Amen. Your sovereign hand.
thank you for who you are. Father, we come and we lift up those who are sick and who are hurting. Father, dealing with the illness, Father, that you would come and tend to them in a way that only you can do. Lord, we pray for those on our prayer list, Lord, that you would come and just fill them with your presence and your love. Father, this morning, please help us just to give to you and to worship you through our giving. Lord, and help us to bring honor and praise to your name. We thank you for all things. For it's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Let's go back to that little place where we used to go in the summer days. The lodge by the water's still my favorite place, and I could come every year and it wouldn't change.
Mother's Day, and treat mothers for a little bit. Let's give them a break. Sixth grade below, you can go downstairs.
Dude, you were supposed to just leave it there.
As the kids are moving that way, parents that want to dedicate their children, I'm going to ask you to come to the front row right over here. This side, move yourselves on up here. Rest of us need to turn our Bibles to 1 Samuel chapter 1. So if you have a child you want to dedicate this morning, just come on up to the front row where Kyle's at. Today's Mother's Day. The question that many of us ask ourselves in this adventure called life, and we ask ourselves this every year, is what do you get for the woman who brought you into this world, who loved you and brought you up and taught you? What do you get your mother for Mother's Day? I think, Joe, I think you nailed it this morning. You got Helen exactly what she wanted. She is so happy to see you this morning here. Gentlemen, what do we get the woman who brought our children into the world on Mother's Day? And I thought about that, and I thought about that, and I thought about that, and here's the answer. Whatever she wants. Whatever she wants. Mothers are special. In 1 Samuel chapter 1, we meet a woman who wants to be a mother more than anything else. Her name's Hannah. But Hannah was not able to become a mother right away. She had fertility problems going on, and she was grieved greatly, and so she goes to the Lord and she makes the plea in verse 10. She says, it says this, in bitterness of soul, Hannah wept much and prayed to the Lord, and she made a vow saying, O Lord Almighty, if you'll only look upon your servant's misery and remember me and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head. Hannah just wanted a child so she could get that child to the Lord and that child be used for the glory of the Lord. She wanted her child to know the Lord. And isn't that what every one of us wants? And this morning we have parents up here bringing their children and saying, I know these children all belong to the Lord. And He's entrusted me with a precious little guy, little girl, little guy, little guy. You're outnumbered this morning. And these parents are saying, I know that God has entrusted this child to me. And I will raise this child in the fear of the Lord, in the truth of the Lord, in the light of the Lord, and in the Lord's church. And we're so blessed, all you parents and these little ones who are ready to dedicate these children to the Lord. So church, would you pray with me? And later on in the message, I'm going to explain to you the commitment you're making as a church. So let's pray together over Jacob, over Parker, over Kylie, over Ezekiel. We're going to start out here with Ezekiel. Lord, we lift Ezekiel up to you. Thank you for sharing him. Thank you for blessing the family that knows to bring him to you and say, I know he belongs to you. I thank you for the influence. I know Big Sister will be in his life as well, and the gifts that she's already used. Thank you for the parents, Lord. Ask your blessing upon his life. And Lord, we come over to Parker and we lift him up to you and we thank you for sharing him with us. But we thank you for his big sister as well, his parents. And we just ask, Lord, that you just use his life for your glory. And we just know that he's yours and that we will see great things come in each and every one of these children's lives. Lord, we lift up Kylie to you. And we just thank you for the big family she belongs to and that she's been brought to you and she's your child, your daughter. And so we just ask your blessing upon her life as she is used for your glory and your kingdom. And Lord, we lift up Jacob to you, all smiles and happiness. It's such a blessed, blessed boy to belong to such a wonderful family as well. And Lord, I just thank you so much for sharing him with us. And then we get to see his brightness of light every day and the joy he brings to others. And so, Lord, you use him for your glory. We thank you for these children. We thank you for these parents. We ask your wisdom and discernment to be upon each and every one of them as they live for you. In Jesus' name, and all God's people say, Amen. He started to nibble on my tongue while we were praying. You all are so blessed. Thank you for sharing your precious little ones with us and letting them be a part of their lives. It means so much. Lord, bless all of you. And you just did a great job, by the way, singing this morning. Didn't we all enjoy that? You guys can go sit. You can stay up here front row. It's no extra. Or you can go back to your families. Either way. Hannah dreamed of that moment. She always wanted to be able to do that. To have a child, to be brought up and dedicated to the Lord. And to make Hannah's situation more difficult, we find in 1 Samuel that her husband has another wife. Yes, she has a sister wife of what we would say in today's culture. If Phinehas, her sister wife, was mean to Hannah, and she would provoke her, and she would make fun of her because she didn't have any children of her own, and it was to the point that Hannah was just grieved. And I believe some of you here this morning can probably relate to Hannah's grief. You wanted a child of your own, but that's never happened. Hannah understood your grief. And I pray that today God will comfort your grief with His Holy Spirit, that you will find fulfillment in other children around you as well. And then there's some of you today who are grieved because your mother's no longer here on this earth with us. Hannah was grieved. And she was grieved to such difficulty that she had a bitterness in her soul. If you experience bitterness in your soul, I think sometimes we all have, but hers was because of grief. And so she would weep and she would pray to the Lord And she made a plea to God. And I love that she made her plea to God, because in James we read, "Is any of you troubled? Then you should pray." And she knew. I asked this morning, are any of you troubled? I often go over my sermon on Saturdays. I go out to the camper so nobody can hear me, and I go over it in there. And every now and then, Paul will follow me into the camper. He'll sit there and play with his Matchbox cars. And last night when I got to that part, I said, "Is there anyone troubled?" I was preaching just like I would to you. And Paul said, "Dad, I'm troubled." I said, "Paul, what are you troubled about, buddy?" He goes, about hitting the water thing with the bat. Last week, he was out there playing baseball, and he was using the real baseball, so I moved him to the side of the house where there wasn't any windows, but there was a no-freeze water hydrant, and all of a sudden I heard a ting, and I was like, uh-oh. I ran around, and thank goodness it hadn't broke or anything. I said, "Paul, you can't do that. You can't hit that, because this is an accident." I said, "You cannot hit that. Well, go all the way to the road to shut the water off if you bust that thing." He said, I'm troubled over that. I said, "Paul, I love you. I don't want you to be troubled over that. You know not to do it now. And that's all the reason I told you not to." He said, "I feel better now." It's behind me. Now, isn't that the way it is when we just, like a child, bring our troubles to God? And cry out to God and let Him know. Everything we deal with here on this earth are footstool problems. What do you mean by footstool? Well, the Bible says that the earth is God's footstool. So everything we get stressed out about here on this earth, that's what the Lord lays His feet upon. They're footstool issues. And He wants to step in there and help us and remind us it's going to be okay. You don't need to worry about that water hydrant. It's fine. And even if it would have broken, it's fine. But most of us aren't honest about our troubles, I find. No, we don't like to admit that, but some will say, "We're in the midst of trouble and grief." And some will say, "Hey, how are you doing?" "Oh, I'm good. Yep, I'm good." And you know when we're lying, because we say it over and over and over, trying to convince ourselves that we're actually good. Or is that just me? Maybe you can relate. Maybe I'm just the one with this issue of not being authentic about my troubles. Maybe it's that we're worried that we'll be judged by others if we really tell them that we're troubled, if we try to hide it. But what I found is that God knows all about our troubles. He knows all of our concerns, all the things that are stressing us out, about the uneasy feelings, and He instructs us to give Him our plea. I give my plea. That's what He wants us to do. Come, I give my prayer. I give my plea. Lord, I'm troubled. Lord, I'm troubled over the argument me and my wife had. I'm troubled over our wayward child. I'm troubled because of our out-of-control finances. I'm troubled over my employer's threats that our company may be moving, or that I may be fired, or my sibling that's lost. Lord, I'm troubled because I've made this calendar, and there's no way we can keep up with it. Help me, Lord. I give you my plea. I give you my health problems. I give you my addiction. I give you my eating disorder. I give you my grief, my struggle with sin. Lord, I need your help. You know the way I'm feeling. Here's the thing. You may be really strong. I get that. I mean, some of you guys especially are really strong. My wife is really, really strong. She'll surprise you. She's mighty. But you know what? None of us are strong enough to carry our troubles. None of us. You can't carry the suitcase of troubles. What we're designed for is to transfer our troubles, to give our troubles over to the Lord, to not carry them ourselves, but to let Him have it. Yesterday, Aurora was actually gave me a call that was troubling. It was a phone call. Any of you have teenage kids? Just wait. Just wait if you don't. You will never have a weekend again once you have a teenage child. Just letting you know. The way it works. Smile as you remember. Well, here's the just typical weekend. We lost track practice after school, and then she goes to a friend's house. And then at the friend's house, they go to her friend's church lock-in. And then the next morning, we're supposed to pick them up from there and take them back to the school because there's a track meet that she's supposed to help organize. So we have our schedule planned. We're going. Aurora leaves to go pick up Emily. She picks her up, and she calls and says, we have a problem. So what's the matter? She goes, I got there, and Emily, she's hurt her ankle. And I had to carry her out to the car. Of course, me being a father, how'd she hurt her ankle? Well, they were playing a game at the church at 3 o'clock in the morning, and they had all the lights out, and they were running around. You ever wonder why sometimes senior ministers and youth ministers don't get along? There's your answer. We get along great around here. Every now and then we disagree on things. Shutting the lights off, 3 in the morning, in the dark, having kids run around here. It wasn't here, by the way, it was in another church. There's going to be problems. I immediately say somebody's going to get hurt, and just enough, my daughter was the one that got hurt, and immediately I was troubled, I was upset, and I was defensive, and this overprotective fathering spirit came out, and I even told my sister this, and she said, you sound just like Dad. I said, this is why I said, you know nothing good happens after midnight. It's even the church, nothing good happens after midnight. Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
Nothing. Then I began to think about Emily and how she's worked so hard this whole year training up for sectionals that is Tuesday. Been running. She's ready for sectionals, got her times where she wants them, and now she's out. The season's over 3 days before sectionals. Well, I was studying this sermon when I received this phone call, and I was at this point, I give you my plea. I didn't want to give the Lord my plea just yet. I wanted to give a few other things out there some pleas. But I didn't want to give the Lord my plea. I said, you know, I'm going to practice what I preach. And so I talked to the Lord about it. And I asked for Emily's ankle not to be broken. We still don't know the news on that. But I asked him to help her in the midst of her hurt, just that it'd be a great day and just not ruin everything. You know, his peace has attended our family. And Emily, she's around here somewhere this morning, probably helping downstairs with her foot elevated, smile on her face. She's happy. She's good to go. God's heard my plea. He's answering that prayer. On Monday, May 1st, Mark Fairman went missing in the Morgan Monroe Forest, I believe it was. And you remember the first week of May was an extremely cold week for me. It was odd. It wasn't like this temperature we have now. And it was wet. And Mark somehow got lost in the forest there. Thursday morning, he was still missing. On that Thursday morning, May 4th, many of us were gathered for the National Day of Prayer. Remember that, Teresa? And you remember that Brother Craig got up and he said, you know, I'm the chaplain for the DNR, and before we have our prayer service, can we lift up this man that's missing? Because from here I'm going to the forestry where we have our guys out looking for this gentleman. And so we did. And we prayed for Mark, who's been missing since May 1st. It's May 4th now. And we just made a plea to God. And we prayed for those searching for Mark. And we prayed for Mark. And I'm sure there were countless people on National Day of Prayer lifting up Mark, that he would be found. I'm sure that as people saw the news, they immediately began to pray for his family and for him. Well, it wasn't long after we got back to the office here. Kyle, he's always getting the updates from the news. He goes, I got something really cool from the news. He said, ends up this gentleman, Mark Fairman, he was just found. Like an hour after everybody was praying. Now someone says, coincidence. I believe that God hears the plea of his people and he intervenes. God is good. And in 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 12, Hannah knows God's good. She takes her plea to God. And as she kept on praying to the Lord, Eli, the priest, he observes her mouth. Hannah was praying in her heart and her lips were moving, but her voice was not heard. And Eli, I don't know what his congregation was like around there, but he thought she was drunk. And so he says to her, how long will you keep on getting drunk? Get rid of your wine. What are you doing coming in here pleading to the Lord? You're drunk. Notice that Hannah's plea was heartfelt. It was emotional. Yet she's misunderstood, even by the priest, for being drunk and out of her mind. You know, sometimes we're misunderstood by people, even good people. All of us sometimes misunderstand one another. We may judge one another, not understand our intentions or circumstances. But the good news is that God knows everything about us. He knows our heart, and so we can give him our plea. We can talk to him about everything. If you need to cry, cry. If you need to be quiet, be quiet. If you need to get loud, get loud. He can handle it. Cast all your anxiety, all your cares on him, for he cares for you. I love the old hymn, tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. Are you weary? Are you heavy laden? Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. Remember that hymn? It's a great one. We can get real with God. You don't have to come to God and talk to him in King James language. You can come and just talk to him the way we talk, the way you talk to anyone else. But you can get real with him, and that's what he wants. He wants a real relationship with you. Don't want you to pretend like you're not dealing with these things. Hannah had a bitterness in her soul that troubled her. She wasn't drunk. She told Eli, I'm a woman who's deeply troubled. I've not been drinking wine or beer. I've poured out my soul to the Lord. Do not take your servant for a wicked woman. I've been praying here out of my great anguish and grief. When someone's pouring out their soul, let's come alongside them and let's lift them up. I love seeing, especially, I think our ladies in the church, y'all are so good at this. And us guys, we're still learning. But I see one of the ladies come up in service, dealing with something, and I immediately see Becky there beside her, Bonnie, or I just see Ellen. Y'all come along together and you lift each other up. And it's beautiful. And you carry these burdens along with one another. You know, Eli, when he saw what was going on, he came alongside of Anna in the midst of her grief, and he lifted her up. He prayed with her, and he comforts her, and he says, go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant you what you have asked of him. She said, may your servant find favor in your eyes. Then she went her way and ate something, and her face was no longer downcast. So she made her plea, and her grief and her anguish was no longer. She had found some peace. Some of us this morning really need to pour out our souls to the Lord. We need him to lift us up. And you need to know it's not unchristian to be troubled. It's really not. It makes you human to have troubles. Not unchristian. Doesn't make you weak. So give your plea to God. Humble yourselves, the Bible says, before the Lord, and it's him who will lift you up. Also, we read the Bible into something else. So if we have troubles, bring them to the Lord. What's something else the Bible says? It says, is anyone happy? Is anyone happy here this morning? Yes! Most of you are happy. Did any of you get the gift you wanted for Mother's Day? All the hints that were dropped and the things you circled, you set out for him that you didn't see. It was all just delivered just right. And you're happy this morning. Well, the Bible says, give God some praise then. If you're happy, give God some praise. We often come right to the Lord when we're troubled and let Him know everything about this troubling us. But do we come to Him and give Him praise? I praise You, Lord, for providing. I praise You for another good day of health. I praise You for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. I praise You for You have created all this beauty around us. I love that our church has windows. I can see out there because I can see the beauty. See how green it is out there? That's life. God created life. Lord, I praise You for giving us life. I praise You for giving us Your Word. I praise You for giving us hope, for saving me. Lord, I praise You for being You. You're worthy of my praise. I praise You that You've made us a perfect heavenly home. Lord, thank You for pouring out Your Spirit on Your church and moving among us. Lord, continue to fill us because I leak a whole lot. So I need You to fill me up more and more. Thank You for Your grace. I love You, Lord God. What's something you can give God praise for this morning? Anybody, just shout it out. Just shout it out. Give Him some praise.
My wife.
Your wife. Amen.
My kids.
Your kids. Grandchildren. Mother.
Health.
Family.
Morning, the day.
Did your car start this morning? You know, I've drove some vehicles. I've owned some vehicles. I praise God every time they start. You ever have a car like that? You'd think you worked all the bugs out. Next thing you know, huh? Mine threatened to do that to me yesterday. Yo, Pacific, I hit the start. Oh, no. Well, that's not helping. I sit there, shook my head. Thank You, Lord. I love this car. You're still breathing. You wake up and open arms. Praise God. Lord, I praise You for Marty and Sheila Corey who are with us this morning who pour out love. And Lisa and Paul pour out love on these beautiful young ladies that are here with us this morning to share Your love with others. Praise God. There's so much to be thankful for. Oftentimes I find that when life is so good, we forget to give God some praise. We say thank You, but we don't thank Him for everything. For example, that car. Like I said, I remember times, cars I've had, you said a prayer of praise every time it started. And you've owned that same car. I can tell by some of your expressions. There's so much to thank God for. So much. We just need to look around. You ever wonder what God's will for you? Is to be thankful in all circumstances. That's what the Bible tells us. Gratitude is the will of God. The first 10 verses, the 1 Samuel chapter 2, Hannah praises God because He's answered her prayer. She's happy. My heart rejoices in the Lord. The Lord has made me strong. Now I have an answer for my enemies. I rejoice because You rescued me. No one is holy like the Lord. There is no one besides You. There's no rock like our God. The Bible says, rejoice in the Lord always. And I'll say it again, rejoice. I call on the Lord who's worthy to be praised. Last week we said, but we are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that we may declare the praises of Him who called us out of the darkness, out of muck, out of sin, and into His wonderful light. Is anybody happy about that? Mm-hmm. To be raised in the light? To be given some glory of God is just shining down on you and lifting you up? God is good. And all the time, amen. Let Him know. Let Him know He's good. He likes that. I've noticed that mothers, what you like about more than anything is for your child to just say thank you. To let you know you're appreciated and that you're not crazy for sticking it out. say thank you for loving me, for being there for me in the hard times and the good times when I couldn't help myself, for carrying me in your womb. Give God praise. Today, give your mom some praise too. She's deserving. Next, I want to talk about a promise. So we have a plea, a praise, and a promise. Give God your promise. The promises you make to your mothers, keep those as well. Promise is so powerful. You know, Hannah, she promised God, if you give me a son, I will dedicate them back to you for your service. And after her son Samuel was born, Hannah, once he was weaned, she brought him to Eli, the priest. And she says, "Sir, do you remember me? I'm the very woman who stood here several years ago praying to the Lord. I asked the Lord to give me this boy, and he granted my request. Now I'm giving him to the Lord, and he will belong to the Lord his whole life." And we worship the Lord there. This morning we worship the Lord. It's a beautiful act of worship. We brought these children, these little boys and this little girl. Lord, they're yours. They belong to you. And just as Hannah was fulfilling her promise to God by giving Samuel to the Lord, you parents this morning were also making a promise. Lord, I realize these children are yours, and I will raise them for your glory. Fulfilled promise is very powerful. Husband and wife, they enter the covenant of holy marriage, and they make a promise to be faithful till death do them part. How many of you have been married for more than 50 years? You guys are slow in raising your hand on that. Who else over here? Yes? One, two, three. Did I see about six couples raise their hands? Yeah? You know, you don't realize what a witness your promise is to all of us. What an impact it makes on this John and the personal time. To see couples, Rex and Mary, you mean it when they say to death do us part. See couples like Steve and Marsha say, "Yes, I keep my promise." And it means so much. Your promise is just such a light into the world of darkness. It's such a light. It's beautiful. And everybody wants what you have. We say yes. When we see you live it, we say yes. That can be ours too. I keep my promise. Parent dedicating their child to the Lord, that's a promise. God, I promise you that I'll be faithful to my promise. I'll raise them in your life and in your church. And likewise, a church, a body of believers who takes on the name church, makes a promise. A promise to one another in the church. Not a promise to facilities and grounds, a promise to one another. Because we're the body. This is a building. I love it. It's wonderful. It allows us together and worship the Lord. But this building that surrounds us is not the church. You're the church. And as a church, we've made a promise to one another. Not just to the Lord, but to one another. That we'll be accountable to one another. That we'll pray for one another. We'll lift each other up. Now, there's a prayer list in your bulletin. Keep your promise and pray for your brothers and sisters. A promise that we'll be there for one another when times are good and also when times are not so good. A promise that whenever there's children brought up here and dedicated to the Lord, that we will be the example that that child needs to see. That we will be people who live in the light, that we'll become the light of God with the hope, the help of the Holy Spirit. And we will guide these children. We'll love these children. It's a promise. So let's fulfill our promise. On Wednesday night I met you, Cody, and you really impressed me by the time I met you. Cody had called and wanted to come to church here on Wednesday night and start coming here. And Cody, no doubt, has a wonderful, loving mother who's taught him about the love of Jesus, because I noticed that he has John 3:16 right there on his arm for good. We picked up Cody. Cody had a change of clothes with him. He wanted to make a promise to God. I want to show you his promise. Cody, when you publicly did that, you made a promise that you will follow Jesus. We're going to hold you to that promise. Sometimes people don't like it when I hold them to the promise. I had a young man a few weeks ago come in and start to kind of brag about partying the night before. I said, you know what's amazing? You're talking about that party, but you missed the party we had for Jesus on Sunday morning. He didn't like that. I don't really care if he liked it or not, because I've made a promise to be his pastor. I'm going to love him. I'm going to guide you in the truth. We've made a promise to one another, haven't we? We've made a promise to our Lord. What do we give? What do we give? We give our promise. We give our plea. Yes, we give our praise and we give our promise. In Acts chapter 2, Peter preaches a sermon. Oh, it's heartfelt. The Holy Spirit is upon the people. And the people that he is preaching to, they were the ones that were in the crowd whenever Jesus was on trial yelling, "Crucify!" They were the ones insisting that Jesus be crucified. When Pilate tried to release Barabbas, it was these people who that Peter was preaching to that yelled out, "Crucify!" Who had done the wrong thing. They knew what the right thing was to do, but they didn't keep their promise to God. And they had missed the Messiah being in their presence, and they had took place in crucifying Jesus Christ, the Messiah. And they're cut to the heart, and they know they've messed up. Have you ever known that you've really just messed up, that you've missed the mark, or made a big time mistake? I know whenever I do that, I want to know what I can do to make it right. And so they want to know that. And they said, well, brothers, what must we do to be saved? And Peter had already told them that Jesus went, he died, he was crucified for your sins on the cross. You need to believe in him. He said, you need to repent of your sins and turn to God. I want to stop right there for a moment, because we oftentimes go right to be baptized and we leave out this repentance part. And I believe in Scripture, all the way from the Old Testament all the way through the New, we see this same message. The Israelites were promised a land. What was it called? The Promised Land. And they were moving towards this promised land. But to enter the promised land, they had to leave the old land. See, you can't walk into the promised land if you're still in the old land. You can't be in the promised land of Indiana if you're still in Kentucky. No, no pun intended there, but when our grandpa saw the flatland, he was excited. He knew he could grow something to live on there. Go to the promised land, you have to leave the old land. So Peter says you need to repent of your sins. You need to turn away from that and turn to God. And you be baptized in the name of Jesus. What's he saying? He's saying you believe in the name of Jesus. And as you're baptized, you bury that old land, and you come to live in that new land for the forgiveness of your sins. And he says, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This indwelling Spirit that helps us become the light of God. I give that to you, God says. And then Peter says, and this promise. This is a promise from God. It's for you, your children, and to those far away, some translations for those yet to come. Who's he talking about there? Talking about us, Doug. Talking about Justin and Malachi. For all the Lord our God will call. This morning I just want to close in asking, you want to make a promise to God? 3,000, about 3,000 made a promise that day when Peter gave that invitation. They were added to the church. And they pledged their promise in baptism. Is there anyone here this morning who wants to make a promise to God? And if so, we're going to stand, and as we stand and sing, you come to the throne with your plea, your praise, with your promise. You never regret it. Leave the old way. Come to the new way. Promise you a new life. We're going to stand now and you come as we sing.
Once again, happy Mother's Day to all you mothers. We hope you have a great rest of the day.